Hi folks, this is Melvin from OptoProductions.com, and in this video I want to show you some of the more advanced features on the Nord Lead, or Nord Rack in my case. Let's dive right in. In my previous video about the Nord Lead 2, I already talked about the basics, so if you haven't watched that video yet, go watch it right now. The Nord has an incredible amount of features, especially for a 90s synth. The fact that you get four independent slots that can be layered together is really awesome, and even today there aren't that many synths that can do this. So let's take a look at how this works. On the Nord we can select one of the four slots, A, B, C or D, and we can change these programs independently. You can also select a MIDI channel for each slot by holding down the shift button and pressing the MIDI channel button over here. By the way, all of these shift functions are clearly labeled on the right hand side of the synth. So now I can change the MIDI channel for the currently selected slot, and I can press another slot to change that to another channel. If I hold down shift and press the MIDI channel button again, a G appears, indicating that this is a global MIDI channel, and this is used to send and receive program change messages. To exit, simply press shift again. So this is one way of controlling the Nord, but we can also enable performance mode right here. And this allows us to save all the four slots into one preset, which is really useful in a live situation where you want to easily recall all the slots at once. And also, not only the sounds are saved with each performance, but also most of the advanced functions, including the MIDI channels. So that's something to keep in mind. Also note that these performances are not references to the original programs. They are completely independent, except for the percussion kits. I'm just gonna leave the performance mode because I want to talk about the outputs first. The Nord has four physical line outputs, but we can configure these in various ways. We can do this by holding shift and pressing the out mode button. And now you see CD appear. If I press shift and out mode again, I can cycle through output A and B or C and D. Okay, if you take a look at the right hand side, we've got four modes to choose from. The first mode will combine both slots and send them to both outputs. But if you enable unison, then this will add some stereo width. The second option is the same, but mono on both outputs. Then the third mode alternates both slots A and B for every key press. So that's a cool feature to add some artificial stereo. And finally, the fourth mode sends slot A to output A and slot B to output B. So direct outs, basically. And of course, we can do the same thing for outputs C and D. So hold down shift and press out mode again. And usually I use the first option, so stereo when unison is enabled. Now, if we take a look at all the buttons over here, the first button is the tune control. So hold down shift, press tune, and now we can detune the whole synth. And this is shown by sense. So we can go up and down by one semitone. Right next to the out mode, we've got the local settings, and this is for turning off your internal keyboard, if you have the keyboard version. But when local control is turned off, this also means you can no longer use the dials as well. But you can, however, still control them via an external sequencer. I'm not sure why you ever want to turn this off on the Rack version, so let's keep it on. Then under program control, we can turn on program change messages. If I press again, we can enable control data. And lastly, we can allow the internal arpeggiator to send out MIDI notes. And I usually leave all of these settings turned on, especially this one, in case you want to record the notes to your DAW or send them to another synth. We've already looked at the MIDI channels, so let's move on to the special button. And this is a large menu with lots of options. So let's break it down one by one. The first two button presses are indicated by 1 and 2, and these turn on sync for LFO 1 or LFO 2, and the ARP is part of LFO 2. So when you're sending an external MIDI clock to the Nord, you can sync to this clock. And we've got 7 options to choose from. On 1, the LFO restarts every other bar. On 2, it restarts every whole note, then every half note, every quarter note, eighth note, eighth note triplet, and finally every 16th note. So if I send a MIDI clock from the Arteria BeatStep Pro and I've synced LFO number 1, The only thing you need to keep in mind is that the rate dial still functions, so you still need to manually match the rate. Because it's not the rate that is synced, it's only the restart of the LFO that is synced. But this can, however, lead to some cool rhythmic effects. Okay, right, well, for LFO 2 you can do the same thing. So if you enable the ARP, for example, you can also sync this. Right, then we've got the filter envelope triggering. We can actually trigger the filter envelope by an external MIDI device. So if we activate this, we still need to select a MIDI channel. And to do this, you need to press the store button. Now I can select the MIDI channel. And then when you press store again, you can select a MIDI note. So right now, if you see three dashes, it will accept all the MIDI notes. But if you move up, you can choose a note. So let's say I'll put it on C0. Now I need to press store again, and now it's saved. So if I go to sequencer number 2 on the beat step, and let's say I enter in some notes, and I need to turn up the envelope amount. Now I can hear the pattern I just programmed. So if we play some chords, for example. Basically works like a transgate, which is a pretty cool feature. Well, you can do the same thing with the amplitude envelope. So now I've got two patterns, one for the amplitude and one for the filter. And we can also change the velocity to affect the level. Then we've got the next setting, which is the same as the previous two, but now we can trigger the velocity morph option with external MIDI nodes. But I'll explain the velocity morph function in a bit. After this, we can activate aftertouch, and this can be set independently for each slot. If you press the store button, you can select the destination. So LFO 1, LFO 2, filter 1, the FM amount, or the pitch of oscillator 2. So let's say we turn that on, press store again, and then we can change the amount. Well, I don't have an aftertouch keyboard right here, so I can't demonstrate that, but you get the idea. And finally, you can do the same thing, but for an external modulation pedal. Alright, let's finish off the settings with the system button. Here we can change the sustain pedal polarity. Well, that's pretty self-explanatory. After that we can change the pitch bend range in semitones. So we've got one semitone, 2, 3, 4, and then 7, 10, 12, 24, and finally 48. So a huge range. Then finally, you can change the unison detune amount, which is changed for all slots at once. But this setting can be saved to a performance. Alright, let's have a look at the velocity morph function. The velocity morph function allows us to map the velocity to almost any parameter. We need to set up two levels, one for the minimum velocity and one for the maximum velocity. Let's say I want to control the oscillator mix knob. I first need to set the knob to the lowest velocity setting, so to the left, for example. Then I need to press the velocity morph assign button. Now the LED starts to blink. Now I change the control to the maximum velocity setting, so to the right in this case. Press the velocity morph button again. And that should be it. So now if I press softly, we get a sine wave. If I press harder, we get a pulse wave. To clear all the velocity morph assign buttons, hold down shift and press clear. Let's try it on the FM amount, for example. And you can add as many controls as you want. So maybe the pulse width. Now instead of using the velocity on your keyboard, you can also control the morph function with the mod wheel by pressing the shift button until the morph LED is lit. So with this function, you can basically morph between two entirely different patches, which is really powerful. Right, we've already covered most of the features, but there are some miscellaneous features here and there, like the panic button. If you ever experience stuck notes, you can hold down shift and press the panic button to turn off all the notes. And in my first video, I said there's no init preset option on the Nord, but there actually is. And to do this, we need to access the manual mode. If you hold down shift and press the performance mode option, you will see three dashes. So now the Nord has entered a temporary preset, which we can alter. And also the cool feature about this mode is that all the controls line up exactly with the sound. So what you see is what you get. Right, let's say this is a good init preset. And now if you press store twice, these settings are saved. So this is an easy way to have an init preset function. So you can store this to any patch you'd like. Really useful. And in case you missed it, we also got a manual trigger button right here. Useful if you don't have a keyboard at hand. And if you're not in performance mode, you can also layer the different slots together, simply by pressing multiple slots at once. To deactivate this, just press an unselected slot, or if you've selected all of them, simply press them all again. But this is only useful on the keyboard version. It doesn't do anything in the rack version. If you want to layer on the rack version, you just need to set all the slots to the same MIDI channel, which does exactly the same thing. Lastly, I want to show you how to backup your patches to your DAW. And this can be done with the MIDI dump functions right here. Now you just need to create a MIDI track in your DAW, and in some DAWs you need to make sure the SysX data can be received. In Cubase, for example, this is turned off by default. Now I need to press record, and I can either choose to send the current patch only or all the patches. And to dump performances, you need to switch to performance mode first. To send patches back from your DAW, you only need to press play on your DAW. If you send a single patch, this is stored in the edit buffer, which means you still manually need to store it. And of course you can also use a MIDI editor or a librarian, like the one from Aura plugins. Alright, that's it for this video. There's actually one more thing I didn't cover in this video, and that's the drum mode. But I'll dedicate another video to that in the future. If you have any questions, just let me know in the comments, like and subscribe, and I'll see you in another tutorial.